2021. Oh my God. Another year of vaccines and pandemic politics related news items. It's also a year where Kim and Kanye broke up. But you know what? This year was also the year where we saw the return of going into the movie theater. Oh, can't wait to go to the movie theater. Waste my money on some shitty films. A year where films gave us some bad musical adaptations, iconic cartoon characters with live action films, or just so many sequels and reboots and remakes that we never even asked for. Oh, 2021, we love you. Not every film on this list is going to be terrible, or the keyword worse, as a couple of them were pretty disappointing, so that's why I put them on this list. It's not like it's not like I wanted to. I tortured myself to the point where I was just like, you know what? I didn't like that film. I was very disappointed in you. You're going on my list. Ah, what am I kidding? This is another year of just me torturing myself for content for you guys, I guess, because I'm bored. I'm just bored. Let's just keep this short. Like my IQ every time I watch these films. Keep it short. Let's just get on to our list and rank my top 10 worst films of 2021. Don't Look Up kind of was a mixed bag for critics and a lot of people. A lot of people like this film, but also a lot of other people don't like this film. I'm one of those people. This movie kind of disappointed me, actually, because I was really looking forward for this film because it had like a lot of Hollywood heavyweights like DiCaprio, Jennifer Lawrence, Jonah Hill, Meryl Streep. And in the end, this ensemble of Hollywood heavyweights couldn't save this film. I don't know. It's weird. It's very weird. The acting is good in this film for a lot of the movie, and the story has an interesting plot. But no, it starts off well. The beginning, the first act, pretty great, and then you got to your second act, and it's just like it fell and bombed. Like I didn't know what where we were going with this. Like what are we doing in this film? What are we doing? Like Adam McKay has done political satire films in the past. We saw it with The Big Short and Vice. Both those films got nominated for Oscars. As will this film because it is a Oscar-baited film, because it has all these big names. But I'm honestly just like very disappointed by this cash grab film because like the editing for this film was just very terrible. Like, there were so many jump cuts and just that were not needed. We saw just random cuts of like random things during like monologues, I guess. I don't even know what to explain with that. And just like I said, the middle act of this film, the second act of this film, just feels weird and misplaced in this film. Because the third act is like, it's okay. The first act is good. It is good. But then you got that second act, and I'm just like, where are we going with this? Like, the whole movie is pretty much like saying, like, oh, this is what's gonna happen with the world of America. And honestly, I'm just like, okay, but you can at least make it somewhat interesting. I don't know. This movie like disappointed me, and I honestly thought it fit for this list. There could have been other films I could have put on this entry, but Don't Look Up is probably the most disappointing film for me, in my opinion, of 2021, and that's why it is on this list. So in 2016, Don't Breathe came out, and it became one of the most shockingly great films of horror in that decade. A film about young adults breaking into a blind man's house, but then it turns out the blind man's a former vet and has some dark secrets and is a badass motherfucker. And Hollywood decided, let's make a sequel. And let's humanize him. Well, here's the problem here, Chief. That character's dark secret was, well, he kidnapped a woman, kept her hostage, and he also tried to shove a turkey baster up one of the characters with his specimen so he can have a child. That's what we're gonna humanize here. We're gonna humanize that. We're gonna make him a good guy here. Now, it does work for some films to humanize a character, but this We can't humanize a rapist, in a sense. That's just weird, but that doesn't make this film bad. It's how they do it that makes it bad. The first act of the film, I guess, is okay, but once the second act comes, the rest of the film just loses its direction. You know, Stephen Lang does a great job, again, as the blind man, but it's just like, the film feels slow, the editing feels a little bit weird, the cinematography also feels somewhat weird, and the acting, other than Stephen Lang, is just horrible. You know, there's a lot of this film that feels dark and gritty, but it's just like, it's the wrong sense of dark and gritty. And let me remind you again, we're humanizing a man that tried to shove a turkey baster filled with cum inside a woman in the last film. And now we're going to make him a good guy. I just, you don't, no, you don't do, no, no. Oh boy, guys, look, it's another Purge movie. Oh boy. You'd think after Anarchy they would have stopped making this film, but no. So the first Purge is another reason why franchises overstay their welcome and need to die, as this film is boring and not good. Well, I wouldn't say it's boring. It has its moments of somewhat enjoyment, because there are some pretty intense kills here. But it lacks a good script, and it's trying to deal with a social issue that pretty much is, it's immigration, but they do it in a very bad way, I guess, how you would say it. I don't know. I found this movie to be not disappointing, as I knew going into the film it was going to be bad, but I just felt bad for the film because it felt disorganized, because the whole story just like it's everywhere. It's trying to be a Purge movie. It's trying to be immigration movie with social issues. It's trying to be, I don't even know what to call for the third part of this. It's just trying to be something that it's not. You know, most of the Purge films use politics and real life social issues in its story, but they do it in such a unique way. For this one, it just feels like it was just the social issue was thrown in there. But it also feels like the Purge was just thrown in there. You know what I mean? It's one of those films that just like the direction of where it's like going is split into two, and it's just like it doesn't know what it wants to be. You know, there's a lot of this movie that I feel like you could use in a sense for like the Purge series, but then again, that was also bad, so I guess not. I don't know. In the end, I gotta say the first Purge, it's just not a good film in general. It's bad. The story direction is just all over the place, and it just feels like a cash grab. Yeah, it's a cash grab film. Remember when the Fast and Furious movies were just about racing and somewhat of crime, and now they're saving the world, I guess? They're going into fucking space. They're running out of ideas, the Fast and Furious franchise. This is definitely a franchise that needs to just stop. Okay, I get it. Paul Walker died. I get it. You want to make 10 films. No. No. Vin, stop. Please. I am Groot. Stay with that. In this movie, Dominic Toretto has a brother. It took to the 9th film to learn that. And we got a backstory of it, too. In this film, so like, yay. But he's going to stop his brother from destroying the world. Or that's what Wikipedia says. I don't really know the whole actual plot for this film. Because it's just, there's so much going on in this movie that it just feels distracting. There's too much action going on. And the way the cinematography and the effects are in this movie, and I guess the editing as well, it's too much. There's too much going on. It's like, first of all, the story is just like, why are we learning about Dominic Toretto's brother in this movie? But also, how the fuck is Han alive? You see it in the trailer. You see the whole film in the fucking trailer. You see the best part of the movie in a trailer. You see everything. You don't even need to watch the movie. You want to watch the movie? Watch the fucking almost 4-minute long trailer that came out in 2020 or 2019. It doesn't matter. How's Han alive? I just want an explanation of that. And like, they did explain it. They did show it. But it's just like, it makes no fucking sense. Where's the logic in this? And like, why are we going in space? Again,
this was a movie about them going racing.
Why is this a space movie now? You know what I mean? They're running out of ideas. It's being shown. And then, I'm not going to try to spoil the movie, but I guess, why the fuck now? Who cares? A certain character is returning for the 10th film, or at least it's being foreshadowed, and it's played by a dead guy at this point. How are we doing that? I'm not explaining why this movie is bad, because it honestly, this movie didn't need to be made. You know, there's so much action going on. There's so much the editing's terrible. The story is just like, it's not needed. And may I remind you, we went from going from racing cars and barely crime to saving the world and driving into space. I don't need to say anything else of why this movie is bad. If I could explain this in like less than 2 minutes, I would say this. Spaceship A New Legacy, we asked for it. We asked for a second Space Jam, and in the end, I wouldn't take it back, but I would have made it 10 years ago. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like this was 10 years too late, and there's too much going on. Like, the movie feels cramped. We're trying to play a basketball game, but we're in the Warner Bros. Subverse. There's too many cameos. In the basketball game itself, we have too many IPs around the game as the crowd. It's just like, I'm distracted on them, and I'm supposed to be watching the game. Where's the direction for this? The direction feels weird too. The acting is not good. Like, Don Cheadle's probably the only good actor in this. That's kind of saying LeBron James isn't that good at acting. But now I was Michael Jordan. But I like Space Jam. I don't like Space Jam: The Legacy. I would rewatch it because it is a fun movie. But it's just like, it's not a fun movie in the sense of it's good. Not it was the first Space Jam, but this one was like, they're both bad films that are good. But I like Space Jam because I grew up with that. I don't like this one. I don't know. Maybe I'm getting old. Maybe that's what it is. Also, the animation, by the way, looks good. The 2D animation. The live action animation looked weird. Like, Bugs Bunny in live action and the rest of Looney Tunes, they just, no, it don't look right. It don't look right. Like I said, there's so much going on in this movie that feels cramped. And it is a fun movie, but it's just like, it's enjoyable. But I don't like it. It's bad. But I could rewatch it. It's all over the place for me for this movie. Like, I bought merch for this movie. I bought the LeBron James skin on Fortnite. I'll leave you with that. You know, one of those films, it's so bad it's good. And just like, you know it's bad, but you're enjoying it and you're loving it. It's this film, Willy's Wonderland. I didn't expect it. And this is the crazy part. This is the most enjoyable film out of every film on this list. Like, I could watch this hundreds of times. And I'm okay with that. Like, this movie is literally just Five Nights at Freddy's reimagined. But, I mean, it's just not good. You know, it's got an emotionless Nick Cage, which, again, I enjoyed him. This is probably one of his best roles in the last 10 years. But, like, this film is just simply just not that good. Like, the animatronics, I think are good, but sometimes I also think it's just people in costumes acting like animatronics, which, I don't know, it feels off. I don't know. The acting is not anywhere good in this film, other than Nick Cage, who has no lines. It's just weird. Like, all the acting here is one-dimensional. And the reason why the animatronics come to life, the origin story on how they come to life, it's just ridiculous. Like, to some people it's pretty interesting, but to me, I don't know, it's something that you should go back in the drawing board and done something more elaborative, you know. Maybe I need another viewing for this film, you know, because like, it's got its creepy moments and then it has its like disappointing, like, why was that there moments, but just like, it's like, I don't know why I'm placing it here too, because it's just like, I enjoyed the film, but at the same time, I know it's bad, and it is bad, but it's just like, it adds nothing crazy into the horror movie genre, and honestly, it would have been better if it just make a Five Nights at Freddy film, and you are, Hollywood's making a Five Nights at Freddy movie. So we got the ripoff version first. I feel like I spent too much time on the other film, so in light of that, I'm going to make this part very light for this entry, because Thunder Force is just terrible. There's nothing good to say about this film. There is nothing good or positive to say about it. As much as I don't want to say this, Melissa McCarthy has lost her touch. Like, she's playing the same role in each film. And she's also been lately in just films with her husband directing, and he can't direct. He can't write. So put both together, and it's just a bomb going off. Like, this movie's not funny. It just, direction-wise, it's just terrible. It's a ridiculous film. It's a ridiculous plot, but, like, you've seen it before, but it's like, it doesn't work for this film. Like I said, Melissa McCarthy isn't funny. Octavia Spencer isn't funny. I feel like her career is ruined at this point. Both of their careers can be ruined at this point, but nobody will care. And you know how ridiculous this movie is? You really want to know how ridiculous this movie is? Jason Bateman with crab arms. I don't even need to see anything else. Like, I don't know how to explain how ridiculous this movie can be without bringing up that. You know, I'm just gonna just say this is the this is the funny thing. This is the funny thing. Listen up. Here we go. The biggest joke in this film is honestly the entire film. As while this isn't the worst comedy movie ever, it's definitely one of the weakest comedy films within the last 10 years. Like, for me, I would rather watch Paint Dry or the Snyder Cut. And that was 6 hours long. I'm moving on. I'm not gonna lie with you guys. Tom and Jerry the movie, you don't need to watch it. It's a waste of time to watch it, because I remember seeing this trailer. I seen the marketing for this film. I live in New York, and the movie takes place in New York. So the marketing of this film, the posters are everywhere for Tom and Jerry. And I'm like, this movie might actually be good. It's going to be good. And in the end, I'm like, these two iconic cartoon characters are the best thing about this movie. But they're barely being used right, because they're the side characters on their own film. The side characters! They're in the name of the movie, Tom and Jerry. The movie, and they're the side characters. That's like making a movie about your life, and you're pretty much like the background character. What happened here? It's like, the movie's about a wedding in a hotel, and I don't care about any of that, alright? I care about Tom and Jerry, alright? Before I get to the plot and this movie, the animation in this, which is supposed to be live action, but Tom and Jerry, like, animated, is okay. I feel like this is trying to be, like, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, but it's just, like, it doesn't work for the animation-wise, because, like, the way it's edited, it just looks, like, it looks weird. And if you've seen the film, you would understand where I'm going with it. As for the story and the plot, it's boring. Nobody cares about this. We came here for Tom and Jerry, not for some wedding. Because I don't care about the wedding. I don't care about the girl playing the wedding. I don't care about the hotel or its manager. I don't care about the people in the hotel. I don't care about the couple who's getting married. I just care about Tom and fucking Jerry. And they're the goddamn side characters of their own film. Like, they're put into the scenario, and it bothers me the way that they're doing it. It's wrong. I don't get it. It's like, I'm bored from the movie. I don't like the story. The writing is just god awful. It's not funny. Like, there are times where it's trying to be funny and it's not, but the only time that I enjoy it is when Tom and Jerry are doing their shenanigans. But half the time I'm not, because it's like, it's around, they're the side characters, and it's around this stupid wedding. It's like, I don't care. Like, I'm watching this film halfway into the movie, I'm like, I hate it. I don't want to watch it anymore, but I'm doing it for content, because I know I'm going to make a top 10 worst list this year. And I know this is going to be like a top contender, possibly number one. And it's the third film, and we have two more to go. So you know how downhill it goes from here. But Tom and Jerry the movie, horrible. Alright, let's get through this next one real quickly, because I just don't want to deal with it. Home Sweet Home Alone is about a child who gets stuck at home because his family forgot him during their vacation to Japan. What does that sound like to you? Oh yeah, the first Home Alone, and then the second one, he gets, you know, he the second one's better, I'm just saying, but he gets on a different plane, so he's not technically Home Alone, but it works. But this formula's gotta stop. And for this movie, the kid we're supposed to root for is a little bitch. I want to fucking strangle him. Ooh, abuse this kid. I want to abuse this kid. That's so wrong for me to say. But it's like the couple we're rooting for here. And even then, it's like the couple we're rooting for here. Here's the reason why. Well, they're stupid. This is why we're rooting for, I'm not wanting to root for them. But it's like, they're stupid. And the reason why we're rooting for them is like, the kid supposedly stole his their little dolly that's worth a lot of money. So it's like, the kid's the bad guy here, pretty much. And it's like, why? This movie's not funny. This movie has no funny jokes, except one. They made an OJ joke, and I laughed. But because it's in a very adult joke. He gets arrested the second time. It's like, you're putting a murder trial for OJ Simpson joke in here, pretty much. In a family film. About Christmas. What are you doing, Hollywood? What are you doing? And if this movie would have came out in theater, and you wasted your $20 to sit in a bed bug infested seat during a coronavirus pandemic, you're going to risk that to see that movie? No. Risk it for Spider-Man. Risk it for anything else but this movie. Actually, I watched this movie for free on Disney Plus. Go watch 8-Bit Christmas. That's a better Christmas movie. But I wasted my time. 2 hours worth, by the way. This movie's fucking, it feels short, but it's long. It drags. I wasted my time to watch this movie. And I was like, you know what? Maybe it might be good. Maybe it might be like a, you know, it's not great, but it's like, it'll be fine. I checked Rotten Tomatoes after. That's 16%. I watched it for you fucks. I watched it for content. I watched it so I could have a fucking movie on this list. And I knew it was going to be number one. It's not, though. And that shocks me. Like I said, I've laughed one time in this movie for an OJ joke. An OJ joke. Everyone in this movie is stupid. The child is a little bitch. That's all you can say, really. That's all you can say. It's a piece of shit film. I keep tapping on my head. Just wondering why I was watching this movie, yo. And now there's a musical part in this video. Because I can't believe I watched a fucking musical of dear fucking Evan Hansen. This movie is so fucking terrible and disgusting. Like, I can't believe I did that. I can't believe I just did that for this fucking film. For content. Fuck! So, this movie is literally just disgusting. The musical itself, the story is about a boy who makes this letter because he has social anxiety. His therapist wants to make a letter, and he writes it to himself. But the boy that finds it, Connor, finds his cast, because Evan Hansen has a cast for some reason, and then he finds his letter, and he storms off. And then the next day, it turns out he kills himself. But now everyone believes that he's his friend. So Evan Hansen goes with this idea, makes a whole fucking story and lie about it. And he also has a crush on Connor's sister the whole time. So he gets with his sister, hooks up with his sister, is lying to the family and the sister about being his friend. Just so he can fuck the sister. This is in the musical. It's downgraded a bit in the movie, but it's still done in a horrible way. It's like, what are you doing? What are you doing? Okay. Ben Platt's in this movie, the original actor in the musical, and he looks 40 years old in this. He's almost 30. He's wearing a wig. He looks 40, and he's playing a 17-year-old. What else can I say about it? The rest of the cast feels lifeless. The acting isn't why this is the worst movie of the year. It's the entire film itself. The editing and cinematography for this film looks horrendous, and the film is a total drag. Like, I'm not kidding. The first hour and a half feels like I'm watching the Ten Commandments. Or the Snyder Cut. I keep bringing up the Snyder Cut. Because the Snyder Cut was long. I paused the movie. And I'd like, oh, the movie's almost over. It's almost an hour and a half at that point. I'm like, there's literally another hour left of this film? Are you kidding me? Like, there's so much wrong with this movie that I'm so happy it distracts me from the disgusting story of a fucking 17-year-old boy lying about being friends with a suicidal victim because he had his letter. And so he lies about this. He continues to lie just so he could get with the girl. That might be sounding off bad, and I might be saying it wrong, but you know what? That's what it is. It happened in the musical. It happens in the movie. It's both just disgusting and terrible. The musical parts of this film are okay, but it's like half the musical from the musical is taken out. Half the songs are taken out, and they're replaced, or they're downgraded. Like, I can't believe I'm saying this, but Cats was better than this musical film. Cats. Cats. Like, the other side of this movie, about the trauma and social anxiety and how the character deals with it and struggles with it, I could watch that. But seeing this disgusting, just realizing, like, we need to realize this. This won a Tony. This musical won a Tony for Best Musical. I got no words. I'm almost 4 minutes into this, and I'm explaining this, and I have no more words. This movie sucks. This is the worst movie ever. Like, I could tell you right now, if you watch this in theaters, just tap on your head a bit. Tap on your head. And just know that you're a fucking moron. I watched it online for free, and I'm still a fucking moron. So, enough said. Dear Evan Hansen, you're garbage.